What I would like to start with is that we have a very different cultural background. Although we are on the both sides of the North Sea, and it's not that far away, it takes only an hour, at least according to your watch, and 2 hours to come here. And we are also a little bit, we have also problems with environmental things, because when sea level is rising, we will all flood, also here. And I heard the best advice of our minister in Netherlands that there's only one answer to that, and that is to learn swim. So there are a lot of things in common, and actually also in history there are a lot of things in common. But there are also very big changes, and that is what I would like to talk about. And for me, it is starts with the vocabulary, the words we use in designing public space, urban design, whatever plans we make. We are an office which works in the field of urban design. Sorry, should I use this?
Yes.
But we, let's say urban design in Netherlands means that we, the landscape we've made is all urban, it's all made. So that means that we also work in landscape design. So in Netherlands it's more or less the same of it. It's very much close to each other. When you compare the English vocabulary with the Dutch, this is an English list of names you use. When I just take a part of the city of London, I have a whole list of names, and you, in English, somehow you have all kind of words for all kind of streets. And when I compare it to the Dutch, we have less, because most of these things we call it all straat, which is street. And there are a lot of things we just don't have a word for, because we don't know. I mean, somehow we don't use that. And for us, it's interesting. Because where we stay, for instance, with the hotel, it's called a terrace. It's close to Hyde Park, and it is an absolutely different typology than, for instance, an avenue or a drive or a crescent. So the richness of this vocabulary is very interesting, because it shows something about how you think of space. You have words for things, and we don't have words for all these things, which means that we don't make it because we don't understand, or it's not somehow in our bagage, so to say, in our minds. We have other things. What's interesting on this is that of course we can exchange knowledge, because we can learn from each other. So I would like to talk a little bit where we come from. Netherlands, we come from two offices in Netherlands. This is Netherlands, we come from Rotterdam. We are two who are dealing with the Rotterdam office. And there's another one in Groningen, which is, let's say, one park of Hyde Park and the other side of Hyde Park. I mean, it's something like 2.5 hours, 250 kilometers, so not that far. Two offices, but both with a very Dutch and very typical background for Dutch offices. But we also come from the Netherlands. And the Netherlands is what is shown a little bit here, is that, let's say, when sea level is rising, we kind of lose, let's say, half of the Netherlands. Well, we can all swim, so maybe it's not that big a problem, but the thing is that whole part, so the part which is actually on the British side, is actually all made land. It wasn't there, or maybe it was there somehow, but we kind of moved it around for centuries and centuries. So where do we come from? We come from a land of mapping, of making land, and this is a picture of Vermeer painting, very old picture, 17th century, that is our golden age. And what's interesting, on that picture, there's a map. So somehow they kind of, it was a status when you had a map like this on your wall, which is pretty interesting to understand. So this is, again, the same direction. So this is the IJsselmeer, this is the North Sea, and over there is England. So it's interesting that somehow these people were proud of having a map like that on the wall. And why was that? That was because we were interested in making land, and all these pieces in this part of Netherlands, and actually this is where Amsterdam is, everything here which has a color is made. It was water, it wasn't there. So you can imagine when someone stops the pumps, or when sea level is rising, that we have a major problem. Why did we make this land? Making land in Netherlands was money-making business. We earned in the 17th century a whole lot of money with trading, and we still do actually. But where could that money go to? And actually, we thought of going, putting it into new land. And new land meant a place to grow your vegetables and all kind of stuff. And actually, we still do that, and we still make money out of that. So we make money out of land making, but we also make money out of what comes from the land. And we even did that in England. We did it in a whole lot of places in Netherlands. And there was a whole kind of business attached to that. So let's say we have all the mills, machinery, whatever kind of stuff. This is the first one, so to say, to pump out the water. So we had this windmill, very modern, and we kind of took the water out of the polders, and we had a whole lot of them. Thousands of them were in the Netherlands. So also this was, of course, business. And we are very fond of business. And the thing is that when you go look to this vocabulary, we have not even this amount of word, but maybe 10 times as much as these words, which all has to do something with this land making thing we do. And when I put here the English words too, it's very little. And I can imagine that some words I just don't know, so I couldn't imagine. But there are absolutely words which absolutely there is no translation for that. I would not know any English or whatever language a translation for that. The only thing I know is that I think that you call a polder a polder. That's the same word. That's our word. So that makes it, where do we come from? We come actually from this land-making thing, and you could call it in French l'art d'ingénieur. We are engineers in that way of making lands, and there's a wonderful book has come out now, where all the polders in the Netherlands are kind of analyzed with the, let's say, the ingredients which you need to make a polder. So the dike to start with, all kind of mills which put it into this tochten, which I cannot translate, and finally you take the water out and move it towards the sea. This word engineer, of ingenieur, we say in Dutch, that comes not from genius or something, but this genie, this in that part of the word, that's actually a word which refers to the military, because this was a military business. The genie are the guys in the army who make all bridges and all that kind of stuff you need to have a warfare. So it is related to military. And we are engineers, that is our title, and well, we are not military anymore, fortunately, but let's say that is where actually it comes from. And it's in that way, I think it also is very much comparable with the word engineering in English. And this is what we did. So maybe it's a bit dark, but this is how these polders look like. So it was, of course, very technical, but we also, I think, make beautiful landscape out of it. These are the bulbs. So, of course, only 2 weeks a year, and the rest of it is, then it's green. But we have also these lanes. So parts in the polder which actually have, a beauty, which comes from this engineering, very technical in a way, but I think it's beautiful. I mean, we love it. And I sort of think that most people here, when you are a landscaper, you kind of love these pictures. And we Dutch people love this. But it's actually very practically made. Then something else happened, because all this money-making stuff and all this making land meant that the people in the cities who were owner of those lands, who owned the polders, actually also would like to live there, because these cities kind of, like London, you know, that's all kind of congestion. So already then in the 17th, 18th century, they want to move out. And actually there started in the Netherlands a kind of culture of making not only the polders, but also make parks, gardens, so to say. So the people were moving towards closer to these polders, and they wanted to make these kind of nice places. So this is where, what is it, our king and your queen Mary or something, started an affair, I suppose. And finally, also this engineering, you can also project on making this cities, because this military, the same engineers, the military actually also thought about the ideal city. So we made all kinds of schemes, which has never been made like this, but in essence, these schemes are put, you can put them on Delft, if you know. Delft, a small university town in the Netherlands, or any kind of Dutch place has actually this scheme. And the shape is kind of, you know, how the landscape goes. But the scheme of the city was this, based on this scheme in a way. The canals, which you see here, the trading, so the stuff came into a canal, it was kind of whatever, manufactured, and then it went to another canal, put in a boat, and then sold to another, someone else, and moved out the city. And of course, they were protected, so you had all these fortifications around the town. So this is very much about engineering. And when I compare that to the first story we heard this evening, also this was very practical, and you can say, maybe it's objective, I don't know, they were very practical, but on the other hand, I think they have delivered the kind of beauty which Netherlands is now today, and which we like very much. When I make a jump towards what we do nowadays, and how we engineer the city, and again, we are still engineers. That's our formal title, so to say. You can be an architect, but you're always an engineer. That has a little bit to do with this polder, because that's the way how we very practically approach these kind of questions. But actually, it has also become, maybe in the last 10, 20 years, what is it? I don't know how the werk wordt, to polder. So you have a polder as a thing, but you can also polder as an activity. And that has a little bit to do with this space shaper, because actually to polder means that you talk with a lot of people and come to some kind of final, what is it, compromise, or let's say final result in how you would like to deal with problems, with questions in the city or in public space or whatever. And that is actually what we do nowadays. And there are a lot of things where we as urban designers work in urban design, landscape, legal, strategic consultancy, all that kind of stuff, which also is to be found in our office. But actually the main thing is that, and I don't know, this is probably not a good word, but I just didn't know how to mention it elsewise. Actually what we do around the plan which we are asked to make is of course a design, because we are designers, but we are also of course like to finally make the design so that it's really out there sometime. So we don't only make a paper plan, but we just like to realize it. And that's what most people also do, because they pay us money to make a plan, but in the end they would like to let the plan be made. Then there is of course an important thing, and that is when you have this kind of conditionary map, let's say the conditions you agree on making a plan, so we make a kind of scheme, a frame, if you like. And we say, okay, when you design this frame and when you design or develop the plan, it takes a lot of time, and we know that we need some kind of means, a conditionary map, I call it in this case, to have this, the conditions you agreed on, to put that in there. So, for instance, the result of this shape, this space shaper, could be part of that conditionary map. So the results from that you can put into a map, and you say, okay, we all agree on that, we polder, and finally that is what we will do, and then of course you need a control. So there's someone who has to take control in that, otherwise the politicians or whatever forget. Or maybe they think it's too expensive, so we don't talk about it anymore, and after 5 years it's gone. We don't agree with that. I show you a few examples. This is an area which we've worked on for many years. It's in Utrecht, it's a central city in the Netherlands. It's a station area, for Dutch understandings, it's a big station. When you use a train in the Netherlands, you always cross Utrecht somehow. And actually what we did there is we made a plan, which has a long history, I won't tell you about that, but we made three schemes. We made a master plan, which actually shows what is space which could be developed, the blue part, by private partners. And we showed the space, the orange part, red part, which is public space. So we defined actually the lines, what is ours, all of us, and what is yours, private party. That's one map. Finally, and then we had all kind of conditions as an overlay on that map. We talk about scale, and scale is not only big or small, but also what does big mean? What is bigness, as Rem Koolhaas would say? Or what is smallness of a quarter? Let's say the grain of an environment. So we had all kind of conditions put over that. It's a model made, it only shows a possibility of how you could do it. But finally, we end up with a very boring drawing, actually, which is a drawing which you could say is this conditionary map, where all kind of conditions, so let's say contracts, are put into. and we have the kind of agenda and we agree on that, everyone puts his signature under it, and then we start realizing the plan. So how does it work? We have this design as more or less as an ambition, and we have mostly we use two conditionary maps, public space and the private space or the building. It's a little bit went wrong there. But let's say the built area and the private area or the public area. And in Netherlands it's different than in I think in London or in England, because public space is we have more public space and there is more money to develop public space, I think, compared to London, where public space is maybe it's publicly accessible, but most of a lot of it is privately owned. So your ownership is different than in Netherlands. So we put this in these two maps, and that can go to a contract with the private parties, it can go to guidelines for the public service, can be a municipality, and finally there will be someone who has to control that. And that's, in our case, an urban designer. So it's not some kind of manager or something, but just someone who really made the plan and say, okay, I go for the quality of this plan. This is another example, also a map for public space. It's in IJmuiden, it's on the sea front in the Netherlands. There's a map, and that's, and we work that out with all kind of, whether it's a maquette or websites, whatever means we can use to explain to people what we would like and to let them explain what they like or what they want. So we use all kinds of means to show and to convince. And there's a map for the buildings, so that's actually more the map for the private, for the owners of the buildings, and there are all kinds of rules in there. And finally, we can also show what kind of, what idea of public space or what idea of housing, and people in this case said that they wanted to have this, what is it, this these roof shapes and not these flat roofs. So there can be all kinds of things in it. It's a booklet like this. And then there's a supervisor who will control it during the times. It can also be the time of realization. It can also be something very else. And that's actually where we, which we did very recently. And it's funny because I can't tell you anything about it because the rest is in Chinese. So you can believe whatever you like. But actually, this was a question for a competition for a park in Kaohsiung, which is in Taiwan. It's a huge park for us. It's 65 hectares, which is in the Netherlands. I cannot imagine. It's twice our biggest park, I think. And actually, we did more or less the same, only it's a competition. So there is not a private park. We could not discuss with people because it's a competition. So we were like, well, we were blank in a way. So we had to think of what do these people think is important. And then it's also in Taiwan, which is there. So, I mean, it's not something you just easily go to. And there actually we had, of course, some clues in terms of the, let's say, the cultural axis, which the city planned in the city. There was environmental issue going on there. They wanted to have all kind of things for birds and nature in the city. I will not go into that, and you can believe it because you probably cannot read it. Maybe there's one who can read it, you can't. It's a huge area. It's a former military camp, which is empty actually for the last 50 years, so it's kind of run down there pretty much. There you see one of their high-rise buildings, and in the back is the sea looking towards China, their friend. So they're all kind of, you can think of all kind of, as an urban designer, you can think, and I think also in Kingston, you learn people to look at how do you access it, what is the use of it, let's say, in a more programmatic way, what is there at the moment, the trees which are there, which you would like to keep. But then in the end, you also come up to the less, I would say, the more intangible parts of a design like this. So you can have all this kind of technical and measurable, tangible things in the design, but what is at least as important is that is the intangible part of it. And that actually we also made a scheme, three layers actually, which we try to put in the intangible parts of the plan, and which finally as a whole makes, at least we hope, will give it a quality, but will give it a meaning of place instead of only a kind of summary of, you know, like it's all accessible and we have all the figures and everything, kind of percentages and everything fits, but that doesn't make a design. So what we did is actually, and you must believe it again, we made a kind of plane, so to say, a sort of surface in which we made all kind of routes, which is very handy for the people because they link all kind of public transport systems to each other, and somehow they can, now they have to move around it. When they step out of the subway system here, they just move like this, and we say, of course, you can, in the future, you can also move through the park, through the area. There's a kind of grid which only shows for us the existing buildings and the existing, let's say, character of the site, the barracks, the trees which are there, the small lanes. And then we said there is something else which is actually, it has this kind of birdie shape, kind of duck in China, which is actually kachung, which is actually, which should address to what people think that the park should be. So this is also in a way a little bit technical, but in the end you have people who don't only walk through the park but really go to the park as a destination, and there they must be able to fall in love, to whatever dream, whatever do, which I cannot think of for them because that's what they do. And actually also there, this is the scheme of the plan, there's a Dutch office who won a competition that is already to be built for a huge cultural center, kind of a people's palace, but then whatever, twice as big or something. So that's scene. But this is the plan where you see that we kind of had this bird shape in there with really a park as a destination, as a park, if you like, Hyde Park. There's a part where the which much more addresses to these environmental issues in the city, and there's of course also the grid, the buildings which are there and which are actually already used by artists, by architects, by all kind of people who use the existing barracks, and sometimes they're nice, sometimes they're full apart, but whatever. I mean, who am I to say that they cannot use it and that they should paint it? So that is actually where we worked it out, and I will not show the whole booklet, but we said there's one thing which is for Kaohsiung, so that's the bird-shaped thing, which is really the Hyde Park, if you like, the park where you really can enjoy, where you go on a Sunday afternoon. There's a part, and that is actually surrounded, or how you say that, embedded in a kind of small canal, so which runs all along the shape, and which is actually shape, and there the Dutch come in, where we organize the accessibility of this part, because they wanted to close it down at night, as most parks in London do, but we didn't put a fence there. But we said in daytime we have water and you can step on flowers from one side to another, so to come from the outside into the park. At nighttime we will raise the water level, maybe they are lit, but you cannot cross anymore. So it's not a fence, but it's very Dutch system in using the water. We do that for centuries. And then we call that the River of Flowers. So there are big flowers in which you can use as a stepping stone from one side to another. Then there's a part which is for the birds. So this is this small little island there, and it has a lot of these local, what is it, the existing trees which are there, the banyan trees, as I said, well, banyan, this strange, well, beautifully shaped trees. And you can all put all kind of conditions to that. And there's a part which is actually for the neighborhood. So that's actually all the area which is around it, and which people can also use when they come home from work. They can just go with their dog into to that part of the park and go out again. So which is much more dealing with the daily use of a park. I mean, I can imagine that you don't have time here every day to go to the Hyde Park and stay there for hours. I mean, maybe you do that once a week, if you're lucky. So actually here also we made different maps and we put a whole set of conditions to that. But it also should still address the imagination of people. So it should not be too, let's say, too scientific or something. I mean, people are just using this park, and you make it for these people, and you don't want them to think or to calculate or to do whatever. They just should do what they like. Of course, there's things for the children, which is an important part of the park. We have some spots where we set in conditions, so to say. In the conditions we put it on these red spots, we want an extra investment in money-wise. We want more money for those places to have special, well, whatever you can think of children. And then there's a whole bunch of technical stuff which I will not talk about too much. There are these existing barracks and people are using that already, but they can use them in any way they like. So we leave them there. We don't remove them. We just leave them there, and if people like to adopt one of these barracks, well, fine. If they want to paint it, fine. We don't we care, but I mean, we will not steer in that. And then there's, of course, a whole bunch of things about plants and trees and etc. That's actually his job. And I think I imagine that also you as a British know much more about that than I do. And there's, of course, the national flower, which is this